He will do it. That's scared. Did you want me just to go ahead or just
lie? Yeah, come on. We lie.
Oh, amen. You're right.
Yes.
Well, let me just say this. We'll come back and sing a little bit more, but I love that. Just stand up and praise Him and declare who He is. Right?
Thank you, sir.
Well, I so appreciated being able to be here Friday night. What an awesome time declaring who God is. And I'll have to tell you, after the evening is over, I went up to Jonathan and I said, look at God.
Amen.
It seemed like when you shared, and what you shared was the precursor with Zanetta. What did Zanetta share? I mean, it's as though the Lord had just part A, part B, and here we are.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to be part C. Of course, you had some C and D yesterday. but some thoughts that came to mind as both of them were sharing. You know, the consistency of the Lord, the message of the Word of the Lord, the history of the Word of the Lord, from Old Testament to New Testament, is a continuing historical story. Sometimes people feel like the Old Testament, oh, that was cool. Gives us a little background. It's history, and that's it. And then now we're in the New Testament. Here's the vitality. But the vitality started before the beginning of time. We just talked about and sang about Jesus being forever God, has been, is, and will be. So what He did was just a continual flow from the Old Testament right through the New Testament. And you know, we're the ones that are going to be stepping into the glory place soon. Man, I'm excited about that. So I just wanted to kind of give some connections when we talk about worship from the Old Testament to the New Testament and then beyond. Even the Psalms. This morning, Psalm 100 is something that was so much in my head and heart. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all these things, you know. And then, for He alone is God. And I went, okay. Wow, we are singing that today. And it's in Psalm 100. I looked at the author of the Psalms. Sometimes it's a presumption that David wrote all the Psalms, and he didn't do that. He wrote the majority. I mean, there's 150 Psalms, which you know that. So the assumption is David wrote them all, but he wrote about 75 of them. And Psalm 100 is one of those that he wrote. So I'm thinking, we are declaring words that God inspired to David thousands of years ago. Look at God. And it's as vital today as it's always been. Amazing. So we talk about the nature of worship in the Bible, and we see the nature of God and what He's calling us to. Now, we know that He's holy. That's one of His attributes. He's holy. So as sinful people, we can't enter into His presence because we'll be just wiped out. But then He created us for Him. It says at the very beginning in Genesis that He said, let's make mankind in our image. What does that mean, in our image? Does that mean that we're holy? That we are God? No. It means that the things that He does, that there's a spirit within us to connect with His spirit. So He made His body, soul, and spirit. So that spirit was alive. We could connect with Him. And it said He would come to visit with Adam and Eve. They would walk in the cool of the night. It's like, and here's the interesting thing. With the angels and things like that, they're just created to worship, right? And He said, I have my mankind that I can just fellowship with, and I'm going to give that choice. I'm going to give them choice. I mean, when you think about it, when someone chooses to give you a call to see how you're doing, it's like, thank you. That's very kind of you. They make a choice to demonstrate their care and their love for you. And it just reinforces this connection and relationship. And when God gave us choice as mankind, man, when we say yes, God, we respond to Him and we say yes. what strengthens that bond with God, right? So here he creates us so we can have this communion with him and just enjoy each other. And then, of course, the enemy came in and tricked Adam and Eve. Is he still doing it today? Yes. Just tries to give false things. And we go, oh, that looks enticing. And then we run for it. And then we go, wait a minute, no. Something inside my spirit, the spirit of the Lord, rises up and says, this is not of me. So then here, the relationship is broken. And then God has a longing in his heart. God has a longing in his heart for the people he made. So this is where the tabernacle comes into play. And he gave instruction, build this tabernacle. And it was the outside, the inside, and the Holy of Holies. Because he wanted to communicate with us, to fellowship with us. Oops, sorry. He wanted it. And because he wanted it, he said, I am not going to leave the separation because I designed them for me. And for me, for them. I wanted this communion, this relationship. And it's been divided. And I am going to stick as close as I can, and they're going to figure out who I am. They're going to find it. So then we had that tabernacle. But since he's holy and there was still the separation, there was just the sacrifices that had to come into play. And it's interesting because the sacrifice was spoken about on Friday. Sacrifice. And now in the New Testament, we are living sacrifices. We give ourselves fully. We don't need the lamb. Well, the lamb of God is sick. But we don't need a goat or anything like that. We don't have to do the sacrifice that would only hold for a certain period of time in the kingdom of the law that was established. So we've got that time. And then there was some destruction. Then they built the temple, the Holy Place. I mean, it goes all through. You see how God is working all the way through. And he's talking to David. He's talking to Isaiah. And in Isaiah, he prophesies of the coming of Jesus. Now, you could be saying, hey, Isaiah, you prophesied this, and it was 2 months ago. Where is he? The day is coming. The day is coming. The day is coming. Where is it? We're going to remain faithful. Because God made the promise. And as we just said, he keeps his promise. He keeps his promise. So it's in this Old Testament and New Testament. Old Testament was written in Hebrew, established in the Jewish community. The people of the Lord that he chose, interestingly, he chose the smallest group of people. Isn't it interesting? Even if you look at a map right now, it still is about that big. God proves himself in the unusual ways, and it glorifies him. You have to acknowledge God, though, because there's no way we can do things on our own. When we know our frailties, we know what we can do. And in Israel's case, we're a tiny group of people. And God does these incredible things. We say, there is a God. There is a God. So in the nature of worship, what we look at is, as we walk through it, I'm going to give you the Hebrew, and then we're going to see that this same idea of worship that God demonstrates in the Old Testament is also in the New Testament. So there are three things. Submission. Second one is service, and the third one is reverence. So in the Old Testament, we have Hawa. Ishtawa is the full name, and that means to bow down, to honor and respect. It's an attitude of submission. We see that throughout the Hebrew Old Testament. And then in the Greek, the New Testament, we say prostrate. That means to fall down, just in prostrate, showing honor. We see the same nature of worship, Old Testament and New Testament. There's consistency about the holiness of God. Second one is service. Abed, that's 289 times in the Old Testament. And it means to serve. And it's the service of God that's expressed in the Old Testament there. New Testament, latronon means servant. And then liturgio is the ministry of the saints. So the saints, the priests served in a certain way in ministry, and then the rest were considered in the servants of God. We're giving ourselves to God. And both of these, worship is service to God in every area of life. Every area of life. We heard that Friday. Mm-hmm. When Jonathan said worship is a lifestyle. We see that. He wasn't just saying that because it sounds good. He's saying it because it's true. And it's demonstrated in Old and New Testament. It's every area of life. The third one is reverence. It's Yah, and it's 300 times in the Old Testament. And it means like the fear of the Lord and afraid of the Lord. And it's not like, afraid of the Lord. It's the fear of the Lord that's a heightened attitude of respect. It's like, I am not going to mess around here. This is serious. God is God, and I am not. I am going to reverence him because I am recognizing who he is. In the New Testament, sibomai, it means to revere, worship, and be devout and God-fearing. Which shows us that worship as reverence, obedience. This is what we see in that demonstration. And it's marked by the practical outworking of the fear of God. So this is obedience out of reverence, not obedience because because I revere, I recognize, I honor, I respect. I'm walking in with you, God, and I'm seeing more and more and more of who you are. I acknowledge it. I acknowledge it. So, please, you can say, okay, let's talk. Pastor Eldridge, we're going to talk about it just the way. It's like, Pastor Eldridge, he's just awesome. And let's say you all just want to, he's just so awesome. And I'm like, great. That's great. So what does that mean? He's awesome. Ah, that's great. Tell me how. Okay. He's super kind. He's a kind of, he gives his time. He sacrifices himself for his ministry. Oh, yeah, that's really cool. He calls and he surrenders himself. That's beautiful. He works his energies, whatever's needed to be done. That's relevant. And he studies and he gives us the truth all the way through. He prays. And then that list starts flying. Like, okay. He's awesome. He's awesome. Sometimes we get that way with God too. Wow, God, you're just good. You're just good. I love God. And your fellow worker says, why do you love God? Well, he's just good. Well, I'm good. No, he's really good. So let's talk about some of the attributes of God. What is it about God? We mentioned a few of those. He's unchangeable. Let's talk about, first of all, he's holy. We mentioned that from the get-go in Genesis, because he's holy. Now, and then because of sin, there was just a falling that took place. But his love pressed in so much that he made a way. He made a way for us. So one thing we know, he's loving. But he's holy. So that we can actually admit, that way we can actually get in to the presence of his holiness and not be wiped out. He said, accept my son, accept his sacrifice, and not only do I forgive you, but I wipe your sin away. That's a big difference. For we can forgive one another, but then coming on, you know, back, you know, I mean, I forgave. And here's the Lord saying, I forgive you, and I make the slate clean. I don't even remember what sin. I mean, it's just as if we've never done it. So that's why, because we accept the sacrifice, we can walk into the Holy of Holies. Because He has made us now holy in His sight. He has wiped that sin away. It is gone. It's not just forgiven. It's forgiven and it's gone. Love it. So we can walk into His holiness and participate with Him, learn of Him. So He's holy. He's pure and sinless. And I mentioned He's immutable earlier. And that does mean unchanging. Another one is He's omnipotent. Omni is the prefix for all. So, and the potent is like, that's powerful, man. That Shawshank thing, that's potent. You know, so, but if you're talking about the nature of something, they're powerful. And He's all powerful. He's omnipotent. That's our God. Holy, unchanging, all powerful, omniscient. That has to do with the knowledge. He knows everything. He's all knowing. That's your God. That is your God. Now, sometimes when we pray according to what we know. Why? Well, I know this. And somebody else needs that. So I'll pray according to what I know. We start praying in the Spirit of the Lord. He drops a nugget of information. We thought, you know what? Wow, okay, Lord. I need to pray this way. Because the omniscient one just gave me some insight as to His will being done. Thy kingdom come, Lord, Thy will be done. This is His will. I'm praying this way. He's the omniscient one. He knows all things. I think omniscience, for me, knowing that God is omniscient, also gives me incredible peace. I don't have to struggle with things, because what I normally would fear, I surrender that to the Lord. And then He just transformed that into faith into Him and His omniscience. And if He knows it, He will walk me through it. I don't need to do that without Him. He's with me everywhere I go. He's with you everywhere you go. Omniscient, all-knowing, sovereignty, supreme power, goodness. We used the word good earlier. Goodness, love. His love is enduring. It's powerful. It changes our lives. Omnipresent. He's everywhere all at once. He's infinite. He's forever. He's compassionate, faithful, full of wisdom. He's our Father. He's merciful. And that's just the beginning of the list. So when you start talking about the attributes of God and you start holding on to it like that, it's just that God is awesome. God is. You start listing His attributes. First. This is why I love God so much. I'm getting to know Him. And He's giving me access so I can walk in and get to know Him even better. And what happens? I worship. The closer I get to God, the more I worship. I just fall on my knees before Him. These aspects of God, submission, service, and reverence, these are not alternatives of different kinds of worship. Rather, they are all three different facets of the single activity of worship. So if we're worshiping, it includes submission, it includes service, it includes reverence, the fear of the Lord. He's so good. Pastor Eldridge, when he asked about coming and was kind of giving the idea of what he wanted to do, and then I saw it was on the flyer. It was John 4:24, and it's this: God is a spirit, and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. That's on the flyer. Yeah, God is a spirit, and they worship Him. If we're going to worship Him, we must worship in spirit and in truth. And so, where is truth? truth doesn't change. It goes back to that new building. It doesn't change. And the truth is, Jesus Christ said, I am the way. The truth remains forever. And the life. No man comes to the Father but through me. So if we're talking about worship, we have access, because of Jesus Christ, in truth. We walk in truth. I got to walk with Jesus. He's going to tell me the truth about myself. He's going to tell me the truth about the day. And I'm just going to go, what do you think, Lord? You know, we have to be close enough to be in conversation. This is how we're changed. This is how we're rearranged. It's wonderful. True worship, when we talk about being in his presence, is a spirit-empowered activity. It's not just a ritual. And I realize that for some people, worship can become a ritual. I'm going to sing this, I'm going to do that, and then I'm done. Now this is, if we're talking about true worship, we're talking about a spirit-empowered activity. You can sense the Spirit of God. And he comes in, and you come in close, and you go, sometimes I end up on my face. Sometimes I'm walking around my house just worshiping, singing, praying. And for the, it was actually 2 days ago, I was just walking around the house and I was just praying and I was singing to the Lord. And then I just start crying because his presence was so close. You can almost reach out and feel it. It was so overwhelming. I was just like, tears are crying down. Like, I went and just walked by the bathroom mirror and I went, oh, you look bad when you cry. Like, this isn't about me. You know, it's just, you kind of get involved with who he is. And then it got so much and I felt like, you know, I just want to surrender and I want to demonstrate my submission. So I just ran. I have just this little stool thing next to my bed, and I just ran to the stool and I knelt down. I want to demonstrate the surrender. I want to demonstrate that I'm for you. I'm all for you. There isn't any part of me that's not for you. I'm just for you. And this is spirit-empowered activity. Then we're talking worship. I recognize you, God. I love you, God. You're so far above me. I'm in awe of you. And I just want to tell you I love you. I just want to sit. Whatever you want. What do you want? God is good. In this case, then, we're talking about singing, leading, walking through life, in the Spirit, with the Spirit, and by the Spirit. When the Spirit comes, you will do things far beyond your natural giftings. And this came to mind, because I knew I was going to say it, when you were speaking earlier, Pastor, about this is kind of the seed of the way you envision what God's going to be doing. This is the seed, and God is going to do greater things than you can imagine. I really feel that, Pastor. And for all of you, you guys are going to be the ones that are going to become the leaders as you lead other people. And this is, I believe, why God's been taking the time to invest in you. That you are the learners, you are the workers, you are the growers. You walk into a spirit activity, then you see how different it is than the natural activity. And we say yes. And it goes like this, we want yes. It's interesting. I don't know if you've heard the name Jerry Riddle, worship leader. Yeah. He wrote this book right here, The Reset, Returning to the Heart of Worship and a Life of Undivided Devotion. Phenomenal. Short book, punching, which is, it's right where it is. So he says this, it is not a theological issue, that's an obstacle to a movement of the Spirit of God. But it's the struggle wrestling with surrender and our fear of relinquishing control. It's like he is talking to everyone now. I don't think anybody would not fall into that category. We all had to do self-analysis and then have a King of Kings walk into the analysis and say, yes, this is true right here. This is the issue. I love that. It's the struggle wrestling with surrender and our fear of relinquishing control. Talk of surrender is popular, especially in the Christian world. But public example in prayer, that's a pretty good statement. Week after week, we choose control over surrender, yet we wonder why there is no power. We want to surrender to the King of Kings. He is the one in control. He is the King of all kings. Whew. We need to get closer to the Lord. We need to know him. As worship begins with some form of knowledge, worship begins with some form of knowledge about God. Revelation is what fuels and informs worship. So we need to get close enough to get to know God. If we're worshiping from afar, it's a form of godliness, but the heart isn't in it. And God is calling us to get close. We need that. We really need that. Love and honor have no power unless they are fueled by the knowledge and revelation. And the principle is this. This is the problem. What you study reveals what you love. So throughout your day, you can ask yourself, man, I love spaghetti. Wait, maybe I should rephrase that. I really like spaghetti. Do I love spaghetti? No. I'm not studying spaghetti. So where we put our time, when you study something, you're putting time there. You're putting effort. You're putting energy. You're putting a percentage of your life there. If you're studying. So if we're studying God, we're studying his word, we're putting it to memory, we're acting in his word, acting in his love, this is a demonstration that reveals that I really do want to be God. I love God. And that is going to become contagious. So true worshipers are contagious people. They really are. Think about the New Testament. Why is it about him? What is it? Tell me what it is about him. Well, it's him. It's Jesus. That can happen at work. Man, what is it about you? You're just always so optimistic. God's in control. I know things are kind of hard, but God's got us. He's good. Wow. In reference to surrender for love, Matthew 10:39 says this. Whoever finds his life will lose it. And whoever loses his life for my sake, for Israel, will find it. So what does that mean? Whoever finds his life. Well, a lot of times when kids are, the teenagers, I don't know what I'm doing. And then they kind of move it. I must say, probably this. Yeah, I'm good at this. So then they find it. But that's all it is. And then they go and it's like, there's got to be more life than that. So then they kind of lose it. They just lose the essence of the vitality. But the Lord says, whoever loses his life for my sake, they surrender all. I surrender, will find it. Because we walk into the very essence of God who created us, who made us. And he said, let me talk to you about you. I've called you this, and I'm enabled to. I've empowered you. Wow. Here we go. You can live in that all your life. My dad is 92 in 2 weeks. And he's a man of God. Wow. It's interesting. Of course, at that age, memory starts to fade a little bit. But you start talking the Word of God. He taught in the Bible college for 22 years. I mean, it just, but he doesn't get, he just starts talking his heart. Just, and I'm telling you, like I said, he's going to be 92. And he's at a nursing home in Iowa. I'm going to go see his birthday coming up. But I'm sitting there, and we start talking about the word, and he talks about scripture. I'm like, where's a napkin? Where's something? I need something to write. Because it's still all these profundities that come out of his mouth and his spirit. I'm like, this is truth. It sets me free, and he just comes alive. You talk about the breath of God, and it's alive in his word. I watched my dad just kind of. It is so, so exciting. So when you lose your life for Christ, you find it. And I tell you, it's forever. Even when our flesh gets weary, it's forever. Praise God. Acts 17:28, this is one of my favorite verses in the Bible. It had left us. I was a teenager. I love this verse. It says, in him we live and we move and we have our very being. So my existence then is in him. Your existence can be in him. Wow, big difference than, I said, kind of a worship, perfunctory thing that I'm going to do. Because I was told I had to, because. Wow. No. Our existence is in him. And when we live in that, we recognize that God calls us to watch him, to observe, to gaze in his eyes and behold his beauty. Just come close enough so you can actually do that. How close are you daring to come? I want to be right there. Psalm 91, he that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall dwell under the shadow of the Almighty. If you are under the shadow of the Almighty, you're pretty close. You know, you're under a tree, you're in the shade. You're pretty close to the tree. It gets a little hot up there, it's like, where is the shade? They're looking for you. It says, he that dwells, lives there, not just comes to visit on a Sunday morning or whatever it is, but that person that lives in the secret place of the Most High. If it's a secret place, that means there's a really unique relationship you have with God that nobody else has like it. And for all the people in the world, each one of us has a secret place. God knows us so well. We abide under the shadow of the mighty. I will say to the Lord, he's my refuge and fortress, my God. In him will I trust. Wow. Yes. I want to come close enough to gaze in his beauty, to know him. Sometimes in worship, these days, it was mentioned a little bit on Friday. Kind of has walked into kind of a Christian culture. It really started in the 70s with the Jesus people type, you know. And it was interesting because the church that I went to, I grew up in the city, and the church that I went to was Faith Tabernacle.
Yes, we
don't
bring up
Faith Tabernacle. Yeah. So I went there for 10 years in my high school years. So very formative. And it was during that time that the Jesus people were coming down from Milwaukee. And they came to Chicago because they felt called to Chicago. They didn't have any place to stay. There's about 50 of them. So they came to our church and said, we had a basement level that was being used. And they said, can we stay here? My dad was on the board too, and so a little bit. And not of the Jesus people, of Faith Tabernacle. And I said, can we stay? They said, yes. They stayed for a number of years. They grew to about 100 and some in the basement. I mean, they kept more people in. And, the Resurrection Band was the Jesus People Band. And it was awesome to see the expense, not the expense, the extent, the expanse of what God was doing. So we can have preconceived ideas, like I said earlier, of what it's going to look like, what it's not going to look like. That's where a lot of this started, And then it moved into the 80s, and then it moved into the 90s, and then I started to become like so popular. The way I did with social media, and it's everywhere. And so now it's like Christian music has its own little, I don't know what the word would be, but a thing. So it can be really popular. And sometimes Christian artists now can fill stadiums of thousands and thousands of people. That never happened way back in the day. I mean, that just, so it, sometimes now it can be almost secularized, if that's the case. So when we're talking about true worship, like we were talking about before, in spirit, in true Bible spirit, it's a little bit different. Now, some of these people, though, are genuine Christ followers, and we are not in it for the fame. But then it says, the scripture says, in due time, I will exalt you. And in some of those cases, God has raised them up because they are saying the right things and giving the godly perspective. It's not just about fame. So God wants us to check our hearts, too. What are we doing, and why are we doing it? So we're talking about worship. We are all in for him because he's number one. We are not number one. We just talk about dying to self, letting him raise up. And if you're willing to do that, he will choose. He will test your heart. He will choose what is, and I'm going to take that person, and I'm going to let them be seen because they look like me, they sound like me, they act like me, and they God trusts and trusts the message to us. So you give it out, he exalts, and he says, I know that they will stand with me. And they will be a light. God calls us to make an impact. He calls us to make an impact. So I'm just praying for this church. Lord, we just pray to you. You just do what you want to do. Yeah, praise God. Well, worship is our all-consuming response to God. All-consuming response to God. He's our everything. Second Corinthians 3:18, Paul writes, but we all with open face, beholding as a glass, the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image. Changed like ourselves, don't know it at all, into who we're looking at. From glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. When we come close, it affects us when we worship. Every aspect of the way we live, we change. We are transformed from glory to glory. We begin to look like him, to act like him, talk like him. And that's when you're going to be affected all those around you. Don't be afraid of that. You don't have to. Why? Because it's Christ in you, the hope of glory. Let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. So it's all about coming close. Is it okay if we just say a few things? Wow. Well, you know what? I'm going to give you that one thing first. Next to the one right before the verse that you gave on your sheet, Jesus is speaking in Spirit to woman. She said, the hour is coming. And now it is, the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father is seeking such to worship him. And then we have the verse, God is the Spirit, and that worship him must worship in spirit and truth. I love that. The hour is coming and now it is. Eldridge, Pastor Eldridge. The hour is coming and now it is. Get ready. So I would like, if you just want to take a few moments just to do that, to enter into his presence, to just be with him for a while. He might be just speaking some deep things in your spirit. He may want to say something to the church. I'm not going to share what he wants to do, but he's here. So on your sheet, I'm just going to start with a song called Here I Am to Worship. You probably know some of these, but the whole idea is just to spend time with him. Just to spend time.
Joy unspeakable.
Just pray as you give yourself to Him deeply, over and over. You'll begin to understand worship in such a deep, new way. I know that when you sit here in your presence, all things are new. Thank you, Lord. You're going to be doing a lot of new things in our lives. You're going to be making arrangements, rearrangements in our lives. Thank you, God. This church will glow just because you're in it. You've been welcomed in this place, welcomed by your saints, by your sons and your daughters. Strengthen them, I pray. Strengthen them. I pray that they would rise up in ways they never have or something new. You're doing something new in each individual life. It's going to look different. Thank you, God. We just want to look like you and sound like you. And Lord, in your omnipotence, you will empower us to go beyond what we can ask and think, because you have said you're going to do it that way. Stuff, things, ideas. Beyond what we can think on our own, we're going to do it by your power, by your might, by your instruction. So give us ears to hear what you're saying. And I thank you that the obedience of what is required will take place, and we will see.
Praise the Lord. We thank God. I pray that those that are here, you just not be hasty, don't rush to leave the presence of the Lord. And those at home, I would encourage you as well to allow the Lord to speak to your heart at this time. If you find yourself in a moment of tears, let them flow. If you find yourself in a moment of laughter, let it go. But allow the Lord to continue what he's begun. What better do we have to do to spend time in God's presence? Let's not rush away. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I pray for those under the sound of my voice, Lord. I pray, Lord God, that you would spring up a desire of worship. Because worship is a lifestyle. Worship is everything. Worship is valuable. And now we're learning that worship is all about you. We say thank you, Lord. Continue to lead us. Continue to guide us, O God. That we may come to know you even the better. Counterfeits won't do. God, we desire you. We say thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. I thank you for those that have been watching. I pray that the Lord will be with you until we meet again. God bless you and keep you. Watch over you. In Jesus' name. Amen.